Those intros really freak me out every time. They're so well produced that the energy in them, I'm like, I'm never going to match that energy. So every time I see them, I'm like, So hopefully I can roughly meet that energy. And also, in relation to what Ronnie just said, it's kind of about web development, this talk. And you'll see in a minute. What do Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg, and Elon Musk all have in common? Yes. They are very successful, but that's not what we're talking about. Experts have suggested that all three of these men show signs of borderline psychopathic behavior. And we're not talking about the Jack the Ripper murdery kind of psychopath. In fact, the definition of psychopathic behavior doesn't really talk much about murdering people at all. It talks about the inability to see something from someone else's point of view, or a complete lack of empathy. It kind of seems that being able to detach yourself from the daily struggles of the people that report to you is a key factor to success as really high senior tech leadership. But I'm pretty sure that we all know by now that empathy in senior leadership is a superpower. Data has shown again and again that empathy in super leadership unlocks creativity in organizations. In a study, it showed that companies where they mark their senior leadership as showing empathy, 67% of people in that organization said that they felt that they could be creative in their day-to-day job. In companies that showed that the leadership lacked empathy, the number plummets to 17%. There is also data showing that empathy is linked to productivity and a high rate of desire to stay at an organization. But if you Google successful tech leaders who lead with empathy, it shows no real-life examples. It just shows you the theory. So it would suggest that empathy doesn't go hand in hand with success at senior tech leadership. Do we have to give up that empathy to be able to succeed as we climb up the chain of leadership? I want to show you that you can scale empathy, and I want to give you a simple tool that will help you to build a network of empathy within your organizations. I am not a psychopath. I don't know why everybody laughs whenever I say that. I guess it's the kind of thing that a psychopath would also say, right? In fact, the problem that I have lies at the other end of the empathy spectrum. I have too much empathy. The feelings and the emotions that I have for people and their struggles really causes me pain on an ongoing basis. I mean, I can't really even watch reality TV shows with feeling pain. I recently cried at the season finale of Selling Sunset. I mean, it was heartbreaking. Like, Chrishell and Jason, they couldn't come to that agreement on whether they wanted children, and it was awful. And there's also, like, a TV show in the UK called Doghouse, where they take, unloved homeless dogs and match them with their pet. And for the first episode, I just bawled my eyes out for the whole episode. I'm starting to swell up a little bit now. In 2019... I had a small reporting line, just two engineers. I led well, and I led with empathy. Dealing with the emotional challenges of two people was easy on a day-to-day basis. It was rarely that those two people would have some kind of challenge at the same time. Fast forward a few months, and I took on a group leadership role and then took on some additional responsibilities in Klarna, and I ended up with 25 people reporting to me. All of a sudden, the emotional struggles of those people started to pop up across the organizational structure. Dead pets, family bereavements, all sorts of things like that, all alongside the day-to-day struggles of working in a hyper-growth company. All of these things started to bubble up to me at the person at the top, and I started to really struggle. I was not able to deal with it. I was unable to sleep, it was keeping me up at night, and I was really, really stressed out about it. I reached out to some people. I reached out to a couple of people who are other senior leaderships around, senior leaderships in Klarna, and I got a very similar response every time. Like, I'm Phil, I just don't think I'm as empathetic as you. I don't really have this problem. So I got into a state where I was like, maybe senior leadership is just not the right place for me to be. Maybe my kind of like personal skill sets are just not right here. Maybe I should take a step back. I was really, really struggling. Alongside this, I was still really, really struggling. I couldn't sleep, so I reached out and got some professional help. I sought therapy. And the thing, in the first therapy session that I had with my therapist, she said something to me that really, really changed the way that I look at this. She said, "It's really interesting that you have 25 people reporting to you. That is the limit of number of clients that I'm allowed to take at any one time to limit the stress on me." And then we talked a little bit, we talked a little bit about my problems, but we also talked a little bit about how our jobs are actually kind of fairly similar. And we talked a little bit about the techniques she uses to deal with that stress of dealing with those kind of problems from people who are a client. I don't want to say clients, what do I mean? Patients. And then I started to get really, really interesting in therapy techniques. So I started to research a little bit more and more therapy techniques. And I came across a therapy technique called solution-focused brief therapy. And it really scratched an itch deep in my brain. The reason why is it works in a very similar way to how we work in product and engineering. You use a simple process to define the problem space, and then you work through a series of steps to get to the solution. It's kind of what we do day to day. The really interesting thing that I found about solution-focused brief therapy is it starts with a miracle question. So you ask the person, imagine you went to bed at normal at night, and then a miracle happens overnight. When you wake up in the morning, the thing that brought you to me today has disappeared overnight. How does that feel? This allows you to identify a perfect future state with that individual, and then you can work out the steps to get there. So I started using this in a simpler form with some of my reports when we had some challenges around these kind of things, and it started to work really, really well. So I kind of wondered, is it possible to take this and apply this kind of process or a simplified version of this process in my day-to-day job? So I defined a six-step process that I wanted to try and use within my organization. Starts with the first step, what's up? Check it. If someone is coming to you with these kind of problems, it's likely they have some sort of stress or they're in some sort of like heightened emotional state. So just checking in with them, asking them what's going on, and just setting a kind of baseline with that relationship is a simple first step. But just asking them, like, what's going on? The second step is to ask the miracle question. I mean, asking that full miracle question is a bit weird in this kind of context. So asking something simple like, if you woke up tomorrow and the problem was gone, what would that look like? Or if the problem just went away overnight, how would that look? Is an easy way to define that. And then you simply sit back and allow them to talk and share their feelings. The next point is to connect and set the context of the situation. It's really, really important that that individual trusts you, that you are on the same page and you understand their problem. So if you have a similar challenge or you've had a similar experience, share that with them. If not, replay their situation in a context that you both understand to try and build that trust that you understand how you can help them solve their problem. The next step should be easy for everybody in this room. It's just finding solutions. We've identified what the problem is, and now you need to work with the individual to just work out what those solutions might be. Set up a solution plan and set up some steps that you want to work on this together. The next thing is to check in. What does check in mean? Ah, I remember. checking in is setting a time. Set a time in your calendars to make sure that you have a time to check in. Set at a time, so it gives you that kind of timeline that you know that you have to work through the action points that you've both kind of identified. So you don't just forget about it and walk away. Now, the second step is the most important one. Also, the sixth step is the most important one. Cascade. If you find that this solution has worked for you or the individual, it's really important to cascade it to your colleagues, use it with other people, and share this process and share that it works and share your experiences with it. So, it's a really simple process. What's up? Miracle question, connect and context, solutions, check in, and cascade. Too early. I started to work with this process with my group, and I was really, really anxious about starting to work with the group with this. In theory, I was really asking people to run mini therapy sessions with each other. So what we did is I paired up the people within the group and asked them to run through this process with each other. There's a couple of people in the room who I enforced them to do this. So they're like, fuck, I've got some traumatic memories. But what happened is something that really surprised me. People really, really engaged with this process. There were some conversations that were really surface level and people were awkward and they just weren't comfortable, and that's fine. But a lot of the conversations really opened up and people really started to support each other and share the problems with each other. What that led to was really important to me as the lead of this group. Instead of all of the problems bubbling up throughout the organizational structure to me at the top, the stress of these emotional problems was dealt with within the connections within the group. So as you can see, each person was helping each other within the group. It wasn't just all bubbling up to me. And I could sleep well again at night. So you can scale empathy. I wanted to wrap this talk up with like a compare and contrast and say something like, wouldn't it be great if we use tools like this and similar tools that means that X, Y, and Z are the tech leaders of the future rather than Zuckerberg, Elon, and Musk? But as we said about before, Google doesn't give you any real results for tech leads who lead with empathy. So instead, I want to finish this talk with a challenge to you all. Wouldn't it be amazing that in 10 years' time, when you search for successful tech leads who lead with empathy, either your name or the names of your reports come up in that Google search? Thank you.